My topic for today's presentation is cardiopulmonary exercise test for people. CPET appeared to be the gold standard for assessment of patients planned for major surgical procedures. So it's a reliable and reproducible test, as it can differentiate lack of patient motivation to perform the test from other organic causes of cardiovascular disease. It provides a global integrated assessment of cardiovascular, respiratory, skeletal muscle, and neuropsychological system to exercise, whereas most other tests assesses the single. It helps in the evaluation of both submaximal and peak exercise responses. Why CPET is important? As we know, resting pulmonary and cardiac function testing cannot reliably predict exercise performance and functional capacity, and that overall health status we can't assess by resting pulmonary and cardiac function. So it's better to get evaluation from a cardiac, exercise test. So the indication of CPET as a preoperative tool, these are the indications. If the patient has high risk cardiac causes are there, or the percentage post-operative predicted value of FEV1 and DLCO less than 30%, then climbing test less than 22 meters, shuttle walk test less than 400 meters. These are all the indications of doing CPET test preoperative tool. CPET indices includes as a preoperative tool, we can it's important to assess the VO2 max and the anaerobic threshold, respiratory exchange ratio, oxygen pulse, ventilatory equivalence of carbon dioxide, oxygen desaturation, and cardiac indices. It's not much evaluated in this preoperative evaluation. So as we know, FIC equation at rest is this is VO2. The VO2 is the oxygen consumption by the body, that is equal to cardiac output, that is stroke volume into heart rate, the arterial oxygen content minus venous oxygen content. So in the maximum exercise time, this stroke volume, the cardiac output maximum into oxygen in the arterial minus venous. So coming to the VO2 max, that is the maximum ability of a person to take in and transport and use oxygen. So rate of consumption of oxygen, it defines the patient's functional aerobic capacity. In healthy patient, the VO2 plateau occurs at near maximal exercise. It represents the maximum achievable level of oxidative metabolism involving large muscle groups. So, however, in clinical settings, a clear plateau may not be achieved before symptom limitation of exercise. So, the peak VO2 is taken as VO2 estimate of VO2 max. So, this is a graph showing exercise intensity and the oxygen consumption. So as the exercise increases, VO2 increases, and that it reaches a maximum limit, then it attains a plateau. This point is called VO2 max. So as the exercise increases, this is the resting portion. This is the exercise, and this is after stopping exercise. So as the exercise as exercise starts, VO2 and VCO2 will be increases. Then at a point, the carbon dioxide level shoots up the oxygen and it reaches a peak value. Then after stopping the exercises, it comes down. This VO2 max won't increase after the further exercise. It will attain a peak value, then it goes to plateau. This is the same thing. As the exercise increases, VO2 and VCO2 increases, and it when it reaches the at some point, that is the aerobic threshold point that I'll come later. Then this point, this carbon dioxide overshoots the oxygen value, then it reaches a peak, then it comes down. So the oxygen consumption in men, that equation is the height in centimeter minus age in years into 20, and in women, height in centimeter minus age into 14. So the values more than 20 ml per kg per minute is suggestive of favorable prognosis following the surgery. So if a patient with VO2 max less than 10 ml per kg per minute, it's a high risk of candidates for pulmonary resection. So this patient can improve their VO2 max by recurrent exercise training and all. So coming to the anaerobic threshold, as I already told, as VO2 and VCO2 increases by exercise, at a point, the carbon dioxide level shoots up. This is the point called anaerobic threshold, the intersection of the VCO2 and VO2 occurs. That is less than 11 milliliter per kg per minute. It's a poor indicator, and if it is less than 8 ml, that is very, that patient will have very poor postoperative outcomes. So according to BTS guidelines, if a patient with FEV1 more than 2 liters, we can clear for pneumonectomy, as I told in my previous presentation. And if it is more than 1.5 liters, we can clear for lobectomy. If the patient has less than 2 liters of FEV1, so in that patient, we have to do postoperative predicted value of FEV1 and DLCO. So if the value is more than 40, we can clear for surgery. Which is less than 40%, here the role of CPET comes. So we have to evaluate the value, we have to check for the VO2 maximum value. If it is less than 15 ml per kg per minute, inoperable, and if it is more than, we can take the patient for surgery. Actually, this BTS guidelines and the ACCP guidelines almost same, but shuttle walk test is omitted in ACCP guidelines. And this VO2 max less than 10 ml per kg per minute, the high risk for perioperative death and cardiopulmonary complication. And the patient being considered for the lung resection who have VO2 max less than 15 ml per kg per minute or predicted value of FEV1 and DLCO less than 40, there will be a perioperative death and cardiopulmonary complications. And if a patient's being considered for lung resection who walks less than 25 shuttles on two occasions or less than one flight of stairs should consider as the high risk for perioperative death and cardiopulmonary complications. So this comes the flow chart. If the FEV1 is more than 1.5 liters, we can clear for lobectomy. More than 2 liters, we can clear for pneumonectomy. Or if it is more than 80% of predicted. In patients with the unexplained dyspnea or patients with ILD in the chest X-ray or CT, if there is no symptoms or anything like that, we can clear them. If any findings like dyspnea or consultation or anything in the chest X-ray, we can measure the DLCO. If the DLCO is more than 80%, we can take the patient for surgery with the average risk. And if it is less than 80, we have to do percentage PPO values. So if the percentage PPO values are more than 40, we can take for surgery with the average risk. And if it is less than 30, we can't clear actually. The patient is at increased risk. If the values in between 40 to 80%, perform CPET. So if the value is more than 15, we can take for surgery. Less than 10, it's an increased risk, and 10 to 15 also coming under increased risk group. This is ERS guidelines that showing VO2 max of more than 20 ml per kg per minute or 75% of the predicted, we can take the patient for pneumonectomy or and less than 10 ml or 35% of predicted, operability will be less, chance of operability will be less. Patients with the VO2 max in between 35 to 75% or 10 to 25%, this patient has to undergo split function test. that is both predicted postoperative FEV1 and DLCO more than 30%, we can take the patient for surgery. If at least FEV1 or DLCO post predictive value is less than 30%, then we have to check postoperative predictive value of VO2. If it is more than 35% or 10 ml, more than 10 ml per kg per minute, operability is there. This is the ERS guideline flowchart. This cardiac assess, we have to assess the cardiac function and all. If the FEV1 and DLCO, we have to check the values. If it is less than, if it is more than 80%, we can clear for resection up to pneumonectomy. If it is less than 80%, we have to check peak VO2 value. If it is less than 35%, lobectomy or pneumonectomy not recommended. If it is more, this is more than same, and this is also more than 75% or more than 20 ml per kg resection up to pneumonectomy we can prescribe. Then if it is 35 to 75% or 10 to 20 ml, in that patients we have to do split function test. If the PP of FEV1 or DLCO is less than 30%, in that patient we have to do VO2 predicted post-operative value. So in that patients, more than 35% or more than 10 ml resection up to calculated extent we can done. If it is less than 35% or less than 10 ml per kg, it will be risky. It's a flowchart given in the Fishman. So it's coming on the initial part. It's coming from the initial part itself. The patient have to undergo PFT with no ILD or unexplained dyspnea on exertion. If FEV1 and DLCO is more than 80%, we can clear for surgery. If it is less than 80%, we have to calculate post-pneumonectomy FEV1 and DLCO values. If it is more than 40, we can clear for surgery. 30 to 40%, the borderline patients, this patient has to undergo CPET evaluation. And predicted pneumonectomy values less than 30%, there is high risk of pneumonectomy. And in these patients, we have to calculate the predicted post lobectomy FEV1 and DLCO. If it is more than 40% clear for lobectomy and less than 40% high risk for lobectomy. This is combined VTS ACCP and ERS guideline flowchart, which is given in the anesthesiology one article, which was published in 2018. It is given like high cardiac risk patients. If we have to directly go for CPET test. If it is no cardiac risk, level 1 test, that is include PFT and DLCO. If it is value more than 60%, we can do lung resection. If it is 30 to 60%, in this patient we can offer climbing test and shuttle walk test. So if the value is more than 20 meters in climbing test and walk test more than 250, we can clear for surgery. If the climbing test less than 20 meters and the walk test less than 250 meters, we can offer CPET. And if it is the values, VO2 max values, according to the VO2 max values, if the patient is in the high risk group, we can't do surgery. And if it is the patient is in low or moderate risk, that patient can undergo for surgery. So the contraindication for CPET includes acute MI and unstable angina, on any hemodynamic compromise, syncope, endocarditis, acute myocarditis or pericarditis, and then valvular symptomatic severe valvular diseases, heart failure. These are the absolute indications, and these are the relative indications include main coronary artery stenosis or stenotic valvular heart disease with moderate risk, severe untreated arterial hypertension, tachyarrhythmias or bradycardias, or high grade blocks, degree blocks in cardiac, or hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. These are all the contraindications.